Hi there, Doug Stewart with IT Creations with the HPE ProLiant ML350 Gen 11 server tower. This tower server supports fourth generation Intel Xeon scalable processors for improved performance across the board, plus support for DDR5 memory and PCI 5.0. If you like our channel, hit that subscribe button. It does help our channel and helps us rank higher and my continued employment prospects. In the meantime, let's get to it. The HPE ProLiant ML350 Gen 11 server tower is designed for small to medium-sized businesses, and apparently it's also a good choice for larger businesses looking to support their remote or branch offices. As with seemingly all of the new servers, this tower can also be used for AI, machine learning, and data analytics. Take off those cute little feet and add some rails, and this flexible platform can also find a home in the data center server enclosures. With ample storage, dual processors, and support for GPU accelerators, it can easily support a number of different workloads. Storage scenarios include 3.5-inch drives and 2.5-inch SAS, SATA, and NVMe options. There's even an option supporting up to 12 E3.S drives, which is new to this platform. Also new to this platform, aside from the fourth gen CPUs, up to 8 terabytes of DDR5 memory and PCI 5.0 is support for integrated Lights Out 6 or ILO 6.0 and an M.2 NVMe boot device. This tower has also been outfitted with the latest grille featuring that mysterious X pattern on the front, possibly representing the unknown in mathematical formulas. I think Elon would be quite proud. You have X, formerly known as Twitter, SpaceX, and his son's incomparable name, this, X-A12. From what I've heard, X is just that, X. The AE is named after Fifth Arc, Rune Ash, also a pseudonym for George William Russell, an Irish writer, editor, critic, poet, and painter. The A12 represents the original name of the XR-71, Blackbird. You know, the high-flying spy plane. It was originally called Archangel 12, 12th in a series of internal design efforts by Lockheed Martin for Project Archangel. That being the case, maybe they should have modified it a bit to A1. You know what I mean? I mean, unless there's 12 of them running around, maybe he's a clone. Regardless of all that, one thing it does translate into, bullying for years to come. Back to our regularly scheduled program. Are you interested in the HPE ProLiant ML350 Gen 11 server? If you are, then for a limited time, you can save up to $500 off a system that you configure or that's listed on our site at $5,000 or more. Click that link for more information on this system, and when you're ready to make a purchase, just mention this video, itcreations.com. Underneath that bezel on the ML350 Gen 11, the chassis is arranged with a control panel, media bay with an optical drive, and then three other sections below. The control panel has a DisplayPort 1.1A, USB 3.2 Gen 1 port, and ILO service port. Besides those, an LED button for the unit ID, just in case this unit is rack mounted at some point. Then health status LEDs for NICs, general health, and power on standby button with integrated LED. There are three storage media boxes below. Box 1 at the top with optional media bay between box 1 and box 2. Box 3 is at the bottom. Box 1 can be outfitted for storage or left empty. It can also support up to 3 additional media bays depending on how the system is configured. In other configurations, box 1 is loaded with storage. Storage on this system is flexible. A chassis with 3.5-inch drive bays holds 4 3.5-inch drives by default in box number 3. However, boxes 1 and 2 can also be outfitted with a drive cage with each supporting 4 drives for up to 12 3.5-inch drive bays. And yes, they will support a mix of 3.5-inch and 2.5-inch drives. Although there is also a 2.5-inch chassis that can support up to 24 2.5-inch drive bays with all three storage boxes outfitted with 8 2.5-inch drive bays. Again, boxes 1 and 2 provide space for optional drive cages while box 3 is the default drive cage. Box 3 is also the default for an NVMe U.3 drive kit for the 12 EDSFF E3.S drive bays. With that last one, you cannot install additional 3.5-inch or 2.5-inch drives in boxes 1 or 2, and you will need both processors to install E3.S drives. The system will also support a mixed drive configuration using 4 LFF drive bays in box 3, paired with 8 SFF drive bays in box 2, and also one with 8 more in box 1. Outfitted with a tri-mode controller or just using direct attached storage enables up to 4 NVMe or U.3 or 4 U.2 NVMe drives. System board connectors only allow for SATA drives. On the back of the platform at the very top of the chassis is a place for an optional NS24i-U NVMe hot plug boot optimized storage device. It has two 480 gigabyte NVMe SSDs and automatically creates a RAID 1 mirror volume for redundancy. It's totally plug and play and requires no setup. Not much else to mention about that. To the right, dual redundant PSUs and a number of supported wattages depending on how the system is configured. Below those, a VGA port, then an OCP 3.0 card slot offering PCI 5.0 compatibility and a BY8 connector. Then a serial port, RJ45 integrated lights out management port, two USB 3.2 Gen 1 ports, and another OCP card slot, again compatible with PCI 5.0 but offering a BY16 connector. The upper OCP card slot is specifically for a network interface controller, while the lower OCP card slot can be utilized for a NIC or OCP card form factor storage controller. A unit ID button is squeezed in between the lower OCP card slot and the two USB ports. There are a bunch of PCI slots on the other side, starting at the top of the chassis with the two tertiary riser slots. Popping that side cover off, you can see that tertiary riser at the top, the secondary riser in the middle, and the primary riser at the bottom. Then the fan cage with two high-performance fans in four slots for eight total. A slight glimpse of the motherboard, and then the upfront drive cages with box one on top, box two, and box three at the bottom. Those risers support a mixed configuration with all PCI 5.0 with either 2x16 risers and 4x8 risers. Each of them can be placed in either the primary or secondary riser slots. The one with 2x16 PCI slots also has auxiliary GPU power connectors for those high-end double-wide GPUs. The slots themselves can also be bifurcated for support of, say, an M.2 card with multiple M.2 drive support. The tertiary riser has four slim SAS connectors, only two of which are supported on this server. It features 2x16 5.0 slots that can also be used for GPU support, plus some auxiliary RDX power connectors for removable disk drive or backup. All slots will support 75 watts of power, so if you install a single-wide GPU, like the NVIDIA A2 or Tesla T4, it can be powered directly from the slot without the need for additional cables. Our specific configuration from HPE has 8 SFF storage bays, a single Intel Xeon Scalable Gold 5418Y processor, 32 gigabytes of DDR5 RDIMM memory modules, an HPE MR408i-O storage controller, and one 800-watt PSU. We bolstered that with the addition of 7 more memory modules for 8 total and 256 gigabytes of memory, plus 4 3.84 terabyte SAS storage devices for up to 15.36 terabytes of storage. At full capacity, the system can be outfitted with up to 8 terabytes of memory, with all 32 memory module slots outfitted with 256 gigabyte memory modules and two processors installed. The supported memory speed ranges from 3200 megahertz to 4800 megahertz, like with the installed modules on this system. The controller is a Gen 11 controller just like the system and supports 8 PCI Gen 4.0 host lanes. It comes in both an OCP NIC 3.0 form factor or for a PCI mount with a half-height, half-length form factor and is based on the Broadcom MegaRAID tech. With a P suffix extension on the name, it is a PCI card. Ours has an O for mounting in the OCP slot 14. It supports a full range of RAID options with support for SAS, SATA, and NVMe storage devices. With just a single processor configuration, only 3 fans are installed with a blank. There are a bunch of other fan options depending on configuration, including the need for external fans 9 and 10 mounted on the back of the server when high-power GPU accelerators are installed. There are various fan configurations in between those extremes, too. A row of 8 slim SAS ports are equally divided between the CPUs. As mentioned, 2 more slim SAS connections in tertiary riser 3. VROC or virtual RAID on CPU is also supported, providing enterprise-level hybrid RAID support with a VROC key and the CPU's internal storage controller. VROC is used for direct-attached SAS and NVMe SSDs and is only compatible with storage devices of the same form factor, and the server boot mode must be set to UEFI. An internal USB connector is on the system board and can be used for additional storage by ILO or to boot the system. The system now features ILO 6.0 and can be managed at chassis using a KVM switch or by connecting a keyboard, monitor, and mouse directly. Once the ILO port is connected to the network, the system can be managed remotely through a standard browser. For versatility, the HPE ProLiant ML350 Gen 11 delivers with several storage options, plus support for 4th generation Intel Xeon Scalable processors and upgrades that come with it. Depending on how it's configured, it can support small, medium, and even enterprise business needs. If you like this video, give it the thumbs up and consider subscribing to our channel by hitting that button right there. If you are looking for a server upgrade or replacing some legacy hardware, check out itcreations.com. Have any questions on this platform or any other? Post them in the comments section below. Till next time, I'm Doug Steumann with IT Creations, and thanks for watching.